Random House Audio presents My Life in France by Julia Child with Alex Prud'homme. Read for you by Flo Salant Greenberg. Foreword. In August 2004, Julia Child and I sat in her small, lush garden in Montecito, California, talking about her life. She was thin and a bit stooped, but more vigorous than she'd been in weeks. We were in the midst of writing this book together. The idea for My Life in France had been gestating since 1969, when her husband, Paul, sifted through hundreds of letters that he and Julia had written his twin brother, Charles Child, my grandfather, from France in 1948 to 1954. Paul suggested creating a book from the letters about their favorite formative years together. But for one reason or another, the book never got written. Paul died in 1994, aged 92. Yet Julia never gave up on the idea and would often talk about her intention to write the France book. She saw it in part as a tribute to her husband, the man who had swept her off to Paris in the first place. I was a professional writer and had long wanted to work on a collaborative project with Julia, but she was self-reliant and for years had politely resisted the idea. In December 2003, she once again mentioned the France book in a wistful tone, and I again offered to assist her. She was 91, and her health had been waxing and waning. This time she said, "All right, dearie, maybe we should work on it together." Almost all of the words in these pages are Julia's or Paul's, but this is not a scholarly work, and at times I have blended their voices. Some writers find that the more they learn about their co-authors, the less they like them. But I had the opposite experience. The more I learned about Julia Child, the more I came to respect her. What impressed me most was how hard she worked, how devoted she was to the rules of la cuisine française, while keeping herself open to creative exploration, and how determined she was to persevere in the face of setbacks. Julia never lost her sense of wonder and inquisitiveness. She was, and is, a great inspiration. On August 13, 2004, just after our conversation in her garden, and only 2 days before her 92nd birthday, Julia died of kidney failure in her sleep. But through her words in these pages, Julia's voice remains as lively, wise, and encouraging as ever. As she would say, "We had such fun." Alex Prud'homme, August 2005. Part 1, Chapter 1, La Belle France. 1. Sea Change. At 5:45 in the morning, Paul and I rousted ourselves from our warm bunk and peered out of the small porthole in our cabin aboard the SS America. We rubbed our eyes and squinted through the glass and could see it was foggy out. But through the deep blue dawn and swirling murk, we spied rows of twinkling lights along the shore. It was Wednesday, November 3rd, 1948, and we had finally arrived at Le Havre, France. Paul had been offered the job of running the exhibits office for the United States Information Service, USIS, at the American Embassy in Paris. His assignment was to help promote French-American relations through the visual arts. Paul had lived and worked in France in the 1920s, spoke the language beautifully, and adored French food and wine. Paris was his favorite city in the world, so when the U.S. government offered him a job there, he jumped at the chance. I just tagged along as his extra baggage. We had met in Salant in the summer of 1944, when we'd both been posted there by the Office of Strategic Services, OSS. The precursor to the CIA. Paul was an artist, and he'd been recruited to create war rooms where General Mountbatten could review intelligence. I was head of the registry, where, among other things, I processed agents' reports from the field and other top-secret papers. Late in the war, Paul and I were transferred to Kunming, China. But now the war was over. We had been married in 1946, lived for 2 years in Washington, D.C., and were moving to Paris. We'd been so busy since our wedding day, September 1st, 1946, that we'd never taken a proper honeymoon. Perhaps a few years in Paris would make up for that sorry state of affairs and give us a sort of working honeymoon. As I gazed through the porthole, I realized I had no idea what I was looking at. France was a land I had long imagined, but had no real sense of. In Pasadena, California, where I was raised, France did not have a good reputation. My tall and taciturn father, Big John McWilliams, liked to say that all Europeans, especially the French, were dark and dirty, although he'd never actually been to Europe and didn't know any Frenchmen. I had met some French people, but they were a couple of cranky spinster school teachers. Despite years of learning French by rote, I could neither speak nor understand a word of the language. I was a 6'2", 36-year-old, rather loud and unserious California. The sight of France in my porthole was like a giant question mark. By 7 a.m., Paul and I were ashore, and our bags had passed through customs. A crane pulled our large, sky-blue Buick station wagon, which we'd nicknamed the Blue Flash, out of the ship's hold. Paul finished stowing our luggage away. We wedged ourselves into the front seat and pointed our wide, rumbling nose southeast, toward Paris. 2. Sol Meunier. The Norman countryside struck me as quintessentially French in an indefinable way. Each little town had a distinct character, though some of them, like Yvetot, were still scarred by gaping bomb holes and knots of barbed wire. We saw hardly any other cars, but there were hundreds of bicyclists, old men driving horses and buggies, ladies dressed in black, and little boys in wooden shoes. The fields were intensely cultivated, and the occasional pink and white stucco villa, set at the end of a formal allée of trees, was both silly and charming. Quite unexpectedly, something about the earthy, smoky smells, the curve of the landscape, and the bright greenness of the cabbage fields reminded us both of China. Oh, la belle France! Without knowing it, I was already falling in love. At 12:30, we flashed into Rouen. There the Guide Michelin directed us to restaurant La Couronne, the Crown, which had been built in 1345 in a medieval house. Paul strode ahead, full of anticipation, but I hung back, concerned that I didn't look chic enough and that the waiters would look down their long Gallic noses at us Yankee tourists. It was warm inside, and the dining room was comfortably old-fashioned. We were greeted by the maître d'hôtel. Paul spoke to him, and the maître d' smiled and said something back in a familiar way, as if they were old friends. Then he led us to a nice table. The other customers were all French, and I noticed that they were treated with exactly the same courtesy as we were. Nobody rolled their eyes at us or stuck their nose in the air. Actually, the staff seemed happy to see us. As we sat down, I heard two businessmen in gray suits at the next table asking questions of their waiter, who gesticulated with a menu and answered them at length. "What are they talking about?" I whispered to Paul. "The waiter is telling them about the chicken they ordered," he whispered back. "How it was raised, how it will be cooked, what side dishes they can have with it, and which wines would go with it best." "Wine?" I said, "at lunch?" I had never drunk much wine other than some $1.19 California Burgundy, and certainly not in the middle of the day. In France, Paul explained, good cooking was regarded as a combination of national sport and high art, and wine was always served with lunch and dinner. "The trick is moderation," he said. Suddenly, the dining room filled with wonderfully intermixing aromas that I sort of recognized but couldn't name. The first smell was something oniony. Shallots, Paul identified it, being sautéed in fresh butter. "What's a shallot?" I asked sheepishly. "You'll see," he said. Then came a warm and winey fragrance from the kitchen, which was probably a delicious sauce being reduced on the stove. My stomach gurgled with hunger. I couldn't help noticing that the waiters carried themselves with a quiet joy, as if their entire mission in life was to make their customers feel comfortable and well-tended. We began our lunch with a half dozen...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.